I'm so happy you're here with me today for Manifesting Love with Astrology. It is a class and a date planner for 2021 on how to maximize your chance for finding your soulmate or significant other in the year 2021. When we talk about timing is everything, you know, we throw it out there all the time. Timing is key. You know, in life, you have to be at the right place at the right time to inherit your gifts that the universe is trying to pass on to you. So what we're going to do is we're getting the cliff notes on how to make timing work for us. Astrology is all about the movement of the planets across your chart every year, day in, day out. Whether you ignore it or not, the planets are not ignoring you. So we're going to take a look and see the prime information that you need to know for this year to manifest love. So the first thing we see is that when you meet someone, we have a natural affinity, fire and air have a natural affinity for one another. So what I've done is that say you were out at a, you know, some place, I don't know, you could be bowling, you could be dancing, you could be at a nightclub, and you could say to someone, well, when is your birthday? Instead of asking them their astrological sign, which they will probably give you, but they might just tell you their birthday if they don't believe in astrology. So if they say to you, you know, hey, I was born June 9th, but they don't say they're a Gemini, you can go to this chart, you can look at Gemini, and May 21st through June 21st means that a June 9th birthday falls in that parameter, so you know that you're dealing with a Gemini. So if you're a fire sign or an air sign, you have found a good compatible match. Now what's interesting about air and fire, the reason they're so compatible is that they work together very well. We have air as a strategic planner and fire is the person or the action. It's the verb and the air is the plan. So when we see fire and air couples, we see couples that can be very spontaneous. They're very quick-witted, they think on their feet, they're ready to move quickly. You know, fire warms air, and air is a strategic planner for telling fire where to go, what to do, and, you know, really coming up with a great plan. Very compatible, very passionate. This is a couple that likes to have, you know, a romp in the hay that might be pretty verbal, very heated, could be very off the wall, you know, very mischievous, sort of very much more sort of freedom loving in the way that they approach life. So when we look at fire and air, we're really seeing a natural harmony within the elements that will help any love relationship. When we look at earth and water, we are looking at the, you know, the earth signs Taurus, Virgo, Capricorn, and the water signs of Cancer, Scorpio, and Pisces. Now, when we look at a group of people that are earth and water, we're going to see a much more subdued group of people. When we're at a party and we see fire and air, they're always sort of the, they're making the most noise, they're, you know, they're up and around, they're moving a lot. But when we look at earth and water, we see a much more sort of literally grounded couple. And earth is a vessel for water, and water nourishes earth. So the two signs go together very, very well. So again, we have the same kind of chart for you. If somebody says, well, I was born April 20th, you're going to know that they're a Taurus. So you can really see how you can find compatible sun signs. Also, too, you know, this does not apply to anything in astrology except the sun signs. The rest of the planets move very differently throughout the zodiac, but this is just sun sign astrology. So that's always the beginning as a sun sign. Now, when we look at Ptolemy's formula for happy marriage. Ptolemy was the grandfather, or thought to be the grandfather, of astrology. And his formula for a happy marriage was one of the following combinations. That you should marry for harmony and friendliness somebody of the same sun sign. Now, that can mean different things. Usually it's a very good match. You understand each other very fully. But what it also means is that if you're too ego-centered because of other clashes in the natal charts that you both possess, it isn't always a perfect match, but it's a very, very good match if you want, you're sort of like, I want to marry my best friend, somebody who really gets me. A sun-sun combination is something to look for. Now, the sun-moon combination and the sun-Venus combination are the ones that I see from all of my friends, myself, my family. Everybody has this in their chart. It's virtually for every relationship in my personal family that has lasted more than 3 months, there is a sun-moon conjunction or a sun-Venus conjunction. And the sun-moon conjunction is the yin-yang energy, you know, masculine, feminine, and an appreciation for the differences. It's almost an unbreakable bond for many people. If the rest of their chart is harmonious at all, if they have other significant connections, a sun-moon conjunction can almost defy destruction. It's two people who feel as though, you know, the other half, the sun and the moon, you know, they need each other. So it's a very important combination for a happy, successful marriage. When we look at Sun and Venus, we are looking at the appreciation of beauty and feminine love. It's really, the Sun is the happiest tarot card in the deck. When we look at that, it's Leo energy. It's about romance. It's about the fifth house, sex, children, you know, fun, self-expression. And Venus is the beautiful Empress. You know, she attracts to her with her beauty, with her femininity. She attracts the masculine sun energy. Now, it doesn't matter who's sun and who's the sun and who is the Venus person. It will not matter. It will always work to your favor in that energy. With the sun-moon conjunction, philosophically speaking, the thought is that the masculine energy, the sun energy, is best, you know, experienced or expressed for the masculine to have the sun energy and the feminine and the moon. However, in my family, that's not the case. The moon is a feminine energy, and in my opinion, it's a darn good thing the moon was, you know, the leader here, you know, that the moon was a masculine, the sun was a feminine. And so it's a very powerful leadership by a feminine entity, which has worked out very well in our family. So when we look at Venus, Mars, now we're talking about those really hot relationships that sometimes last forever with a passionate connection. You know, this is a couple who met when they were 20 and in their 80s, they're still having a great time. They're still having that passion, that sexual connection. And it's really all about the Venus and the Mars, you know. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. So we get that Emperor energy, and now we get Venus, which is the Empress energy. So it's very interesting because the Emperor likes to be boss of the entire world, but the Emperor never tells the Empress what to do. So when we look at the tarot cards, now we're looking at a very beautiful connection, and each of them operate in their own worlds, in their own spheres. But what I also see is if there's a Venus-Mars connection that is actually a square or a tense aspect, it can give the life to a relationship in which things are very dramatic all the time. There's always fireworks going on. So when we get tense aspects with Venus and Mars instead of the conjunction, what you can have is a couple that are always fighting or making love, one or the other, because it's that kind of energy. You know, when we look at Sun and Venus, we're looking at Leo energy again with the Empress card. So the Sun card, Leo energy, with the Empress card. When we look at the Sun Moon energy, we're looking at the Sun card, Leo energy, with Pisces Moon. In astrology, the Moon is ruled by Cancer. But, you know, we're really looking at the ties that bind and the ties that keep families successful and together, and couples enjoying oftentimes a lifetime of happiness, happily ever after. Now we have the dates in 2021 when Venus enters various signs. So we are now in Taurus season, and on April 15th, Venus entered Taurus. So if you have a Mars or a Venus in Taurus, this is going to be a wonderful time for you to meet someone. So it's a time when you should get out there, you should take the time to socialize, to accept invitations of friends, go to parties, go to weddings, go to social events. Put your phone down, talk to people when they're, you know, if you're waiting for fast food at a bodega, you know, just have a conversation with someone, because you're going to look good, you're going to feel good, you're going to be highly attractive to the opposite sex, and in a very organic type of environment. So when Venus enters the various signs, if Venus hits your sun, you know, it's a time when you're going to look good, that you could find someone you find attractive. So whenever we see sun and Venus, sun and moon, sun and sun, you know, we have all of those energies going on. It's a powerful time for finding love. But when Venus is transiting, it transits very quickly. Venus is only in the sign for a day. It's typically, if you look at, you can look at the dates. So Taurus, Venus, April 15th. Until it enters Gemini on May 10th. So Venus transits very quickly. If you don't take advantage of the timing, it will elude you. It will be gone in the flash of 30 days on average. And Venus really only will impact you directly for approximately the 3 days prior to the time that it meets one of your planets, whether it be Mars, your Venus, your Sun, so, or your Moon. So it's very interesting, because it's a very, it's only like a 3-day window. So it's important for you to know the date, so that if you're going to take a salsa class or a cooking class that's, you know, a mixed group of people, it really is a perfect time to get out there and socialize. Very important if you want to have some ability to manifest love on your own terms when you're ready to do it. Okay, so now the next thing we're going to look at is how important the Venus transits are through the houses specifically. So this is all based on rising sign. Your rising sign is what determines timing in your chart based on your personal chart. So when Venus is transiting, if you're in Aries rising, Leo is your fifth house, and Libra is your seventh house. So now you've maximized, you have 2 months in which, you know, you can have a Venus transit helping you immensely in your love life. So the pink is the fifth house, the purple is the seventh house. So I put the first 6 signs. We have Aries through Virgo. So those are what you have to look for. You can see that Aries is Leo and Libra. Leo is the fifth house, Libra is the seventh house, so on and so forth. So then I've included also for the rest of the signs, Libra through Pisces. Aquarius is Libra's fifth house. Aries is Libra's seventh house of marriage. So when we look at the transits of the planets, we tend to meet somebody when we have a transit to our fifth house. Because it's dating, you know, it's Leo energy, it's romance, it's sex, it's having fun, it's playful, you know, it's the, you can meet somebody through a creative aspect. You know, if you're an actor, you could meet a fellow actor, especially in the fifth house energy. So when we get to the seventh house is a house of marriage. So typically people meet when Venus is transiting their fifth house. The relationship probably lasts a year or two, and when Venus goes through the seventh house is when they often marry, or some transit that is linked to their other planets. It's amazing to me that people pick out wedding dates without any knowledge of their birth charts. And oftentimes we can see the stressors of the relationship literally by doing a horary astrology chart to look at the day of the wedding to see how auspicious it is for both people. So fascinating energy, fascinating information, as we want to take control and have some say about manifesting. You know, if you want to manifest fresh produce, you have to go to the farmer's market, right? I mean, typically it doesn't just randomly show up at your door, except now we have you know, Uber Eats, and we have all of these delivery services, but you get the drift that, you know, if you want to catch a train, you're probably going to need to go near the train tracks. You know, if you want to catch a flight, you're going to need to go to the airport. So this is really nothing different than that. It's just putting it on our day timer, our, you know, into our Google calendar, whatever calendar you use. But it really is a time when we should really prepare ourselves. You know, if you want to do a makeover, you know, do it just prior to these times. Enjoy yourself. All right, so now we have the dates when Mars enters the signs. So when Mars is conjunct your Venus, now we have yet another time in which you can manifest love and a very passionate, fiery love affair, even if it doesn't become a marriage. So what we have is are the dates. Aries is January 1st through January 8th, and Taurus, Mars and Taurus starts on January 9th. And as you can see, Mars moves more slowly, because Mars in Taurus is going to take almost 2 months to get into Gemini. So as I do this particular lesson, you know, we're at the time of Cancer Mars, which started on April 24th. So again, very good information to know when you're Mars. Mars is fast action, right? Mars is the energy of the warrior spirit. It's a spirit when masculine energy has a tendency to be very bold, very action-oriented. So it's a great time for the Emperor, which is ruled by Mars, to find his Empress, which is ruled by Venus. So very, very important time to go out when Mars is transiting close to your Venus. So the way you find out when you're, where your Venus is, you need to know the degree, because Venus, every house, every sign goes through 29.9 degrees, 30 degrees. So say if you have a Venus on the very first day of, well, say, let's see, if you have Venus at 3 degrees of Aries, we know that the timing of that is linked to the calendar. So 3 degrees of Aries would mean that on the very last day that it was in Pisces would be a time when it would come into effect. So in other words, when the planet hasn't reached the point in the chart where you're located, so say your planet Venus is at, let's go with 3 degrees, at 0 degrees of that sign that it's in, those 3 days just prior to it meeting the actual planet on your chart is when the powerful, when it's the most potent. That's when it's most likely to happen. And it could literally happen anywhere, anytime, any place. So let's take a look and see what we have now for when Venus meets Mars. This is the very fascinating aspect of when Venus and Mars actually start to join together in the calendar in a given year. And it's not very often. It's not the greatest part of the year. They travel at very different speeds. But this year, for those of you who have Venus or Mars in Cancer, Leo, or Virgo, you have an extra boost. You have an extra powerful time when you're ability to meet a very passionate, exciting lover is going to manifest for you. And so what I've done here is I've put Venus and Mars in Cancer. The whole time Venus and Mars are transiting is a period of June 3rd through June 29th. The most potent day of those two planets together is June 11th. So what that tells me is that the person who was born around, let's see, June 11th, okay. So you figure somebody that was born at around the 27th of the month of May is going to be hit with the most high energy for this particular transit. So I will be conducting classes. I will create a playlist of classes this year as I start to do the astrology for love presentations. and I will start that in approximately 2 weeks. So please make sure you hit your notification bell, subscribe, like, comment, so that we can really get this out to people who need it. Share it with your friends on Facebook. Do whatever you need to do. But this is, I'm going to timestamp each of the slides so that you can refer back to them very quickly. So you'll be able to come back to the video. You don't have to jot anything down. You don't have to take pictures. But we see Leo is June 28th through July 21st. August 1st through August 29th is when Virgo is in its power. And each day, July 14th, August 1st, and June 11th are the most powerful days. Now, my birthday happens to be on June 9th. So what's going to be exciting for me is that I have Venus in Cancer. So now I'm going to have an opportunity for love this year. It's going to be exciting for me. You know, good to get your workout in prior to that time. But that is the presentation. I hope you found it useful. Please let me know what you think. Like, subscribe, share, and comment. And I'm so grateful for your time with me today. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.